So I'm a teacher seven, Mr. Barry here. Today is lesson number two for the computer literacy class. Today we'll be going beyond the basics, looking into PC terms, navigation, and going into using your Google Drive and your Google account. Well, let's get started with the lesson. We're going to start this lesson with looking at the parts that make up your typical computer system. The computer is made up of a system or a group of hardware components that work together towards a common end. In this lesson, we'll look at these parts for a better understanding of what these devices actually do. First off, we'll look at monitors. Monitors are an essential part of the complete computer system. LED and LCD monitors are now the standard for the monitor type used. The advantages of LED, LCD monitors are many. They use a tenth of the electrical power. They are also easier on your eyes. They weigh much less than older CRT types. There are even curved monitors out now that have a curved screen. A 22 or 23 inch screen is normally large enough for everyday chores such as email, online shopping, and document creation. However, screen sizes of 24 inches and larger are better suited for working with graphics and multimedia. CPU. The central processing unit acts like the computer's brain. It handles the calculations and logic, which cause the computer to behave in a certain manner. CPU performance is measured in gigahertz. Gigahertz, which is billions of cycles per second. Most CPUs perform well over 3 billion instructions per second. Many computers sold today come with multiple CPUs, increasing performance without increasing power consumption or heat. The two main companies which make CPUs are AMD and Intel. Each has its own advantages and disadvantages. AMD CPUs tend to have a lower cost, while Intel's tend to have a better performance. Case. A computer case is also known as the computer chassis, or tower, or system unit, or even base unit. It is the enclosure that contains most of the components of a computer. Keyboard and mouse. As mentioned in lesson one, these devices allow you to use the computer and input information. The sauces are here to point out special notes, so whenever you see one, pay attention to what he is pointing out to you, because at the end of the chapter, I'll ask questions about those. Hard drive. The computer stores all of your work on a hard drive. This is the same as you storing your writings in a notepad. The hard drive is found within the computer case. Most hard drives sold in PCs in 2016 were well over 4 terabytes in storage size. A 1 terabyte drive has about 1,000 gigabytes of storage space on it. There is now a trend to store more information on cloud-based storage, which means saving data on secure web drives. An example of a cloud storage is Google Drive. Please note, GB means gigabyte. It's a measure of storage. Let us try to understand this term. 1 GB is a very large space. If you are only working with text, it is a billion characters. 1 GB of space can hold over 4,000 high quality photos. And TB means terabyte. Data is stored on hard drives and other media as ones and zeros, or on and offs, which is what we call binary. Just one one or zero place marker is called a bit. When 8 bits are together, they form a byte, which can make a character. About 1,000 bytes is 1 kilobyte. About 1,000 kilobytes is 1 megabyte. And 1,000 megabytes is 1 gigabyte. And about 1,000 gigabytes is 1 terabyte. RAM. Remember, about 1,000 megabytes is a gigabyte. RAM, random access memory, is used by the computer's brain, or the CPU, to store information to complete specific tasks. It works like your brain's memory and allows the CPU to access frequently used information in a timely manner. The more RAM within a computer system, the better the performance of that computer will be. Most Windows PCs sold in 2016 had 8 gigs or more of RAM. Printers. Printers can be added to your Google account so that you can print to your printer no matter where you are located. Printers are normally connected to the computer by a USB or universal serial bus cable, but many printers now are wireless. There are two types of printers. There's the laser, and then there's inkjet. Lasers tend to be cheaper to run in the long run, but may cost more than some inkjets at the checkout. When you register a printer to your Google account, you have access to that printer whenever you are logged into your Google account. This means that you can print your holiday pictures while you are still on holiday. This is because apps, photos, printers, and your social media are not all now connected to your Google account, not to any specific computer or mobile device. Next, we're going to talk about the modem. A modem is a device that connects the computer with the internet. And then we have a Wi-Fi router. A Wi-Fi router is a device that provides a wireless access point to the internet that it receives from a modem. Let's carry on now to page 3 and go on to software terms. When the computer is turning on, we call that booting up. It will normally show a splash screen. The splash screen is one way to tell which operating system the computer is using. Let's look at a few splash screens. Here's Windows 7 splash screen. Windows 8 and Windows 10 splash screen look like this. And then the Chrome OS splash screen looks like this. Next, operating system. The operating system is the software which runs the computer and dictates the behavior of the device. Each operating system, or OS, has a different way of working with the user. In general, one computer has only one operating system. As newer operating systems are released, they normally include more features, require higher hardware specification, and they tend to be easier to use. Each operating system has some sort of start menu, which is where the user starts and finds the applications. Screen resolutions. Screen resolutions means the way that the monitor paints the picture of your work. The numbers that are used in screen resolutions reflect the numbers of pixels or dots that make up the screen image. For example, a screen resolution of 800 by 600 means that there are 800 columns and 600 rows of dots that make up your screen image. Larger monitors can show larger screen resolutions with better clarity than smaller monitors. Here's a typical view of a 24-inch LCD monitor with a screen resolution of 1920 by 1200. Higher screen resolutions produce smaller screen objects, but larger screen areas, as we can see in this example. Here we have a very small monitor, very small screen resolution of 800 by 600, and notice how large the one appears on this screen. Then we have a next screen resolution of 1280 by 800. Now the one only takes a part of the screen and appears slightly smaller. Then a screen resolution of 1920 by 1200, the one appears even smaller again, but takes up very little space and you have a large amount of area to work with. Smaller screen resolutions produce larger screen objects, but smaller screen areas in general. Let's now move on to page number 4 with a pro tip. How to change a screen resolution. Now remember, this is a pro tip, so it's not for my beginners, but for those who've been taking my class more than once. To make it easier to see the small text on a screen, you can do these steps. For Windows 7, 8, or 10, you would right-click right on the desktop, which will bring out this special context menu. Within this context menu, select Screen Resolution, and you should see this next window here. Select the screen resolution that you wish to use and then click on Apply. If you're using the Chromebooks or Chromeboxes or using any of the Chrome OS, go to the Settings and then select Display Settings. As you see here, the Settings window will open, and then select the Advanced Options and then select Manage Displays. Select the screen resolution that you wish to use. Now here's a comparison of two different screen resolutions on the same size screen. You notice how we have a screen resolution of 1680 by 1050. Compare that to a screen resolution of 1440 by 900. And you can see how the screen is painted differently on each one. Notice how the higher resolution causes the text to appear slightly smaller. Another way to change your size of your text on a web page is to simply use the shortcut Control and then the plus to make the screen images or the text larger. And if to bring them back down to size, you use the shortcut Control and minus. So you actually hold down the Control key and simply tap the plus or tap the minus to change the screen size of your text and images. Let's now go on to page number 5. Setting up a free Google account. Now, many of my students who are new to the class do not have a Google account. But for those who already have a Google account, go ahead and log into your Google account now. Having a Google account has many benefits. Number one, a user may check their email by any computer that is connected to the internet. Two, a computer or a Google account allows a user to create or edit documents within Google Docs without having to install any new software besides the Chrome browser. It also allows users to save their documents, pictures, music, and movies in a special online storage that we call Google Drive. Three, it has a built-in virus protection and 256-bit security, which means that it doesn't allow hackers to get into your private information. Four, it will never have a cost for the free account. What do you get with your Google account? Well, you get Hangouts, which is free calling. So that means you can use your laptop or your tablet or other devices to actually make phone calls, as long as you have a microphone. You can also do video conferencing with Hangouts if your machine has a webcam. You also have free social media, so to connect all of your social media together, like Facebook and other social media, tie that together. You get free email and all these other things, such as calendar, free Google Maps, and everything else is all included there. Here's a special note. A Chromebook is a laptop that runs the Chrome OS, making it run fast and secure. So how do you get a Google account? Step number one, to receive your free Google account, open a program to go onto the internet, such as your Google Chrome, by clicking on that icon that you see here on step two. Go on to google.com. if you're not already there. Now remember, this is done by keying in the word Google into the address box and then pressing Control Enter on your keyboard That is, again, if you're not already at google.com. Once you're at google.com, you're ready for step number three. Click on the blue sign-in button or icon that's found in the top right-hand corner of your page, and it'll look like this, that you see on step number three. Let's now carry on to step number, or page number six. You'll see this window here, which will ask you to key in your email address and your password. Step five, if you do not have a Google account, click on Create Account. If you have a Google account already, please sign in now. Sit back and relax while those who do not have a Google account yet create one now. Step number six, enter in the information to create your free Google account. I may want to suggest here that you write down your email address as well as your password that you create so that you don't forget it, so that you can log in at home or using your cell phone or next week when we come back to class. Again, please never forget your Google username and password. So please write them down. You can write them down right here in your book. Adding a mobile phone number allows you to log into your account even when you forget your password. So you're going to enter in a name, and then you're going to enter in a username, which will be your Google email address. Once you've created a username that no one else has, write it down here on page 7. Your username, by the way, cannot be taken by anyone else. So let's say that your name is Don Cleave. You can't use an email address called doncleave@gmail.com because someone else already has that one. If your name really is Don Cleave, you'd have to use something like Don Cleave and then a series of numbers, maybe four numbers at the end, that no one else has thought of already. Once you have that, write it down and then create a password. For the passwords, please use numbers, letters, and a symbol. And to make it even better, have a capital letter as well as a lowercase letter, or you can have more than one. You can then log in to your Google account with multiple devices to access your Google Photos, your documents, any of your music, or any of your other files or work, which is privately and only accessible by you, because it is protected by your long password which you're creating today. Once you are logged in, you will see your name, and you can create a custom photo for your account as well, as you see I have done here. In the upper right hand corner of your screen, after creating your account and logging in, you'll see a little box that says Gmail. This is the link to your email. You also will see a pattern of 9 small squares. This connects you to all of your apps. Now, let's say that you go home and you install an app on your account. Well, when you come back to class and you click on you go into your apps, you actually will see that new app added within your app launcher. Next, you'll see an image of yourself. It may be just a normal thumbnail that's there, or you can customize it. This link connects you with all of your account information. Clicking on the apps icon opens the menu showing you your common apps. So here we see the common ones such as your Google Plus. The red one with a little arrow in it is YouTube. That's where we find videos, and that's where we can find the instruction videos that we have here. If you look, one will be called Drive. This is a place to store all of your files, your documents, and everything else can be all stored in your Google Drive. Next, Introduction to Gmail. Number one, click on Gmail to read your email. Your email should load in a page very similar to the one shown here on step one. We want to talk about the elements that make up your Gmail page. So before going on, let's learn the different icons used within your Gmail. Notice it'll say Google and then Gmail in the upper left-hand corner of your screen. Below that, it says the word Compose. This allows you to create new email to send to people. And then below that, you have folders. Now, your folders would be the inbox, starred, important, sent mail, drafts, and circles. And you can actually send email to your different folders or have the computer do that automatically for you. Towards the center of your screen, you have email that has been sent to you, and that's being sent so that you have the newest mail on top and the oldest mail further down. You also will see the date and time that it was sent to you on the right-hand side. To open up an email that has been sent to you, click on its subject. Now, you can organize your incoming mail into folders by using the filters. And filters are found in your settings. So if you wanted to add a filter, you'd click on the little gear and then go into settings. And then from settings, go into filters. And then say, well, maybe you want email that's being sent from a friend to be sent straight to a particular folder by that friend's name. Next page. To forward that email, click on the small downward facing arrow found on the right side of the email and select forward, as you see I'm doing here. Notice you have many options. You have forward. Forward simply means to receive the email and then forward it or send it to another person. If you want to reply to the person who sent you the email, click on reply and you can write a message back to them. So as you can see, there are many options to choose from this menu. We're now going to be sending your first email. You're going to be sending it to me. So be so kind as to take your mouse and then click on Compose. Two, once you have clicked on Compose, a new window will open in front of your work. Number three, key in the address, selmateacher7@gmail.com within the to box, as seen here. Step number four on page 10, take your mouse and click in the subject line and type in the word hello. Number five, click within the main message box of the email and then key in a short message. Something like good morning or hello Mr. Barry, just a short message. Number six, for extra fun, you may actually drag and drop pictures or even text and video into the main message area of the email to insert those items into the email. And then when you send it off, I actually receive the photos and text. Seven, to change the text size, fonts, and colors, you can use the tools which are found at the bottom of the email window. Eight, after typing in your very short message, click on the send button that can be found at the bottom of this window. Once you discover how to use Gmail, it can be a lot of fun, Now, in class, I can pause it here and I can walk around and make sure everyone's doing well with their email. And you can also send emails to the other students. Alrighty. Let's now go on to Google Drive. The Google Drive is the one place where you can store your documents, pictures, and other files securely. Google Drive in detail. Number one, start the Chrome browser or your Chromebook and then log into your Google account if you haven't done so already. If you have a home computer or you brought in your personal laptop, you do not need to log in and log out so frequently. Basically, on your Chromebook, you just open it up and you're already logged into your account. Two, click on the apps icon found on either the bookmark bar or in the lower corner. It will be on a Chromebook. It'd be a little circle found in the lower left-hand corner of your screen. And that little circle opens up more apps. So we call that the app launcher. Three, the app screen will load, showing you the apps that are installed within your Google account. Number four, click on the Google Drive icon that looks like this there at the bottom of page 10. It's a small triangle with three colors, green, yellow, and blue. Once you have clicked on the Google Drive icon, the Google Drive app should load. Number six, there are now two looks to the Google Drive as seen here. There's the classic look. So some of my students started their Google account before 2013. And so they have what's called the classic look, and you can actually change it back and forth between the views. So I'll go over classic for a few seconds here. Here we have a red create button. This create button allows the user to create new folders, documents, and a host of other types of files. For the B there, that is the upload button. Allows the user to upload any file from the local computer to the Google Drive. C, these are your files within your drive. So this is an area where you can actually view your files and folders. We have D, this is the folder view of your drive. So it allows you to see the folders within the drive. E is the shared with me area. This allows you to see all of the files or even folders that are shared with you from other users. Next, we have the file view options. This allows the user to change how the files appear within the drive, either the list view or even the picture preview. And then for letter G, we have the tools. A tool starts with kind of like a gear, looks like a round gear with knobs on it. This allows the user to change many options of their drive. Let's now go on to page 12 and look at the new look. Now this is for people who have the Google account from 2014 and after. We'll start off with the new button. The new button allows the user to create new folders, documents, and a host of other types of files. It also allows the user to upload files and folders. B, this is the view of the files within your drive. C, this is the folder view of your drive. This view allows the user to see the folders within the drive. D, this is a shared with me area. This area allows the user to see all of the files that are shared with them from other users. Then we have C, This is the file view options. Allows the user to change how the files appear within the drive, either with the list view or with a picture view. And then we have G there, the tools. Allows the user to change many other options within their drive. So how to switch between the classic and the new look? Please note, if you already have the new look for your drive, you do not need to switch it to the older classic view. Number one, from within the Google Drive, you click on the tools icon. A menu will drop down. If you're using the classic drive tools, you go down and notice you have other options, and one of them is experience the new drive. You click that. If you already have the new drive, you have these other options available for you. And this allows you to change the view. So if you were still using the classic, you could switch it to the new. But if you have the new view, you can't really leave the new drive any longer. They now have that option off to going back to the older classic view. Now, please note, in this book, I'm only going to be using the new drive in all of my lessons. We're now going to make a new folder in your drive to organize all of your class work. So, step number one, from within your Google Drive, go down and click on the new button, whether it's the blue or the red one. Then two, click on folder. This will create a new folder. Now page 14. Step number three, the new folder dialog box should open. Key in either project folder 2017, or if it's 2018, you can key in class folder 2018, whatever you want to do there. After giving the new folder a name, such as 2017 or 2018, then click on the blue create button. Six. You will then see the new folder appearing within your drive as seen here. Let's now go on to page 15. Step number seven, take your mouse and click on the project folder that you just created. The folder will change color when you click once on it. 8. After clicking on the project folder, find the share icon. The share icon is located in the upper right-hand portion of your drive and looks like a person with a plus next to it, the face. 9. Once you've located the share icon, click it. 10. After clicking on the share icon, the share with others window should appear as you see here. 11. Key in the address selmateacher7@gmail.com into the text box as seen here. Page 16. Step number 12. Click on the blue send button. 13. After sharing the folder, double click the project folder to open it. 14. The project folder will load, showing that there are no files in it yet. Your Google Drive comes with 15 gigs of free space. If you own a Chromebook, Google adds another 100 gigabytes of space to your drive. If you own an Android phone or tablet, Google will then add a 15 or even 30 gigs more of free space to each drive. Now, just to let you know, the Google Documents, spreadsheets, the forms, presentations, and even the files and other things that you have, they don't count against your space. Now, let's go on to page 17. We have done a great deal in this lesson, from learning the parts that make up a computer system, to creating the Google account and using the Google Drive for the first time. I hope that you make time to review some of the content that we just went over today. Log into your Google account, at home or at another location, so you can get used to the practice of logging into your Google account. I may want to say too that if you have a cell phone, you can go into the settings, go into the account, and then log into your Google account from your Android phone or your iPhone as well. Let's now go over questions for lesson number 2. If you're taking this class for credit, please take a sheet of paper and write your name along the top line. After answering these questions, turn in the paper to Mr. Berry. Question number 1. Which monitor type uses the least amount of electricity? Question number 2. Which monitor type has the most amount of eye strain? Question number 3. The CPU acts like a what? Question number 4. The two main companies that make CPUs are what and what? Number 5. The what holds all of the devices together, which allow the computer to work. Number 6. The what and what are input devices. Number 7. 1,000 megabytes is 1 watt. Number 8. RAM is short for what? Number 9. Which screen tells you which operating system the computer is using to interface with you? Number 10. Booting means what? Number 11. The Windows desktop picture can be changed. Is this true, false, or none of the above? Number 12. Google Gmail is free. Is this true, false, or none of the above? Number 13. Documents, movies, pictures, and music can be stored in what? Is it A, the Google menu, B, the E Drive, C, the Google Drive, or D, none of the above? And I'm looking for the answer that we talked about in this chapter today. You need to log into your Google to retrieve your Google documents. Is this true, false, or none of the above? 15. Google allows you to add printers to your account so that you can print to them regardless of your location. Basically, so you can print to your home printer even when you are away from home. Is this true, false, or none of the above? Google gives you how much free space on your Google Drive? 17. If you give a mobile phone number, then they can call you if you forget your password. The they being the Google account. So is this true, false, or none of the above? 18. The compose button allows you to make new folders. Is this true, false, or none of the above? 19. Forgetting both your Google username and password will make it very difficult to get into your account. Is this true, false, or none of the above? 20. What is the name of this icon? The computer is made up of a system or what? 22. Give one example of a cloud storage. 23. The two main types of printers are what and what? 24. Name the device that connects the computer with the internet. 25. Name the device that provides a wireless access point to the internet that it receives from the modem. 26. What does the operating system do? 27. What is the shortcut to increase or decrease the size of the text on a web page? 28. Can you log into your Google account on multiple devices? 29. Is your Google account private? Do you need to remember your Google username and password? 40. Remember to bring your Google account information with you to class so that you can log into your Google account. And that is lesson number 2. Please finish up those questions and hand them in to Mr. Barry here in class. Thank you very much. For those who are watching on YouTube, please give it a thumbs up. And thank you again for watching and have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.